Hello, everyone. Rob Berthoff here, and excited to continue in the theological track on Sabbath Truth. And this course is ultimately a continuation from the course Bible Truth, where we're going through and just figuring out what does the Bible have to say about different topics. Now, this one's especially important, I believe. If we read through kind of a figuring out what is the Sabbath, right? If we read through a secular dictionary, we'll notice that it begins with the true definition, in my opinion, which is it's a day of religious observance and abstinence from work, kept from Friday evening to Saturday evening. And then it describes another form of worship by witches. And it says, and kept by most Christians on Sunday, and also opposed midnight meetings held by witches. Now, yes, I did group those two together, and you're going to find out why. Ultimately, there's God's way, and there's not God's way. There's God's way, and there's man's way. So let's find out about God's way from his Bible through initially through the story of creation. So ultimately, where did the Bible, the Sabbath, come from? And there's a course that I highly recommend on pattern matching time. But with that, we'll just kind of take a piece of that course out, which is this idea of this seven-day cycle. And we all know about the seven-day cycle, right? We all know about all the different time cycles, right? And we know about the 360 or 365 or whatever number you want to place on it, right? But ultimately, we understand that there's it's pretty easy to spot a year, right? A year is a relationship between the earth and the sun. Now, this is observable, so it makes sense that that's an increment of time. Pretty straightforward. We also have the month. And the month is a relationship, ultimately, between the earth and the moon, right? So this is about a 30-day time period. Ultimately, it's a month. Now, we know about the day, right? Super demonstrable. It's the time it takes for the earth to ultimately move on its axis, something we all see in the day and night cycle. So these are all kind of basic, right? But what about the week, right? This one is interesting because how did we decide on a weekly cycle? Now, there's no celestial significance of a week. Now, I did a bunch of research on this, and it turns out that throughout history, every civilization has used a seven-day week. Quick little, a little back me up here with Encyclopedia Britannica states that the week is a unit of time that has no astronomical basis and is associated with the biblical account of creation. So the week, aside from the day, the month, and the year, the week has no other celestial significance, no astronomical significance, except that it was created by our Creator. So God preserved this week since creation. We see in Genesis how we read the story of creation, how God created the earth in six literal days, finishing the afternoon on what we would call Friday, the sixth day, right? So God worked for 6 days in creation, and then God rested, or he created ultimately the seventh day of rest. And we'd say, okay, well, let's read Genesis 2:2. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work he had made. But, God doesn't need to rest. So there has to be something significant why an all-powerful God capable of creating the earth would actually want to create this delineation in time. Right? There must be something significant with this action of punctuating the end of a six-day work week with a seventh day of rest. Now, we're to learn from this, ultimately, how God has taught us that we should be resting. Right? He clearly shows us that we are to rest on the Sabbath, which is the seventh day of the week. Exodus, again, reads throughout the Bible, 6 days shall they work, and the seventh day shall thy rest. Now, this is more than just any regular day of saying, hey, just choose any day and choose the seventh because it fits. No, it's actually there's significance that we learn in the Bible, starting in Genesis 2:3, and God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. Now, these are powerful words. Being blessed by God, being sanctified by God. Now, we'll learn more about what sanctify means, but essentially it's to set apart or declare holy, to consecrate, to make legitimate or binding a religious ceremony. And interestingly enough, it's also to free from sin and to cause to be morally right or objective. So ultimately what we find out is that the Sabbath is a holy day apart from the week, used to create a holy people apart from the world. We find that the Sabbath was hallowed at the creation. Ordained for man, it had its origin when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Peace brooded over the whole world, and there was harmony in heaven. So this is kind of a beautiful piece that God gave the Sabbath to Adam as a day of rest, as a sign of God's power and his love. The Sabbath is a memorial in the work of creation. It's a token of God's love and, again, the power of Christ. The Sabbaths are a sign to show that we choose God and we want his gift of salvation, right? We want that sanctification, right? We read here that the Sabbath is the sign of Jesus' workings in our life. Verily, my Sabbath shall ye keep, for it is a sign between me and throughout your generations that you will know that I am the Lord that sanctifies you. So the Sabbath has a role in our sanctification. Now, this is incredibly important. I explain this much more deeper in a course on Plan of Redemption. I highly recommend looking at that. But just to kind of get this, the essence of this, you know, I like how Psalms has it, I will triumph the work of thy hands, right? This is not a temporary thing. The Sabbath is not temporary, right? We are to observe the Sabbath throughout generations as a perpetual covenant. It's a sign between God and his children forever. Now, we'll get into literal Israel versus spiritual Israel, right? But we understand that spiritual Israel is us. Anyone that keeps the commandments of God, right, is and has the faith of Jesus is spiritual Israel. So we read in Exodus 31:17 that the sign, the Sabbath is a sign between God and his church forever. Now, others may say that, yes, the seventh day is a Sabbath for eternity, but that only applies to Israel. Now, again, we will talk about that more later, but clearly the Sabbaths were a sign between me and them, right? The Sabbaths are, we're going to find out that they're perpetual and that they will be keeping the Sabbath in heaven. Right? Not just the Jews that go to heaven will be keeping the Sabbath. Everyone will be keeping the Sabbath in heaven. We'll get to this. So, moreover, I gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between me and them that they may know that I, the Lord, sanctify them. Okay? To be clear that everyone who keeps the Sabbath is taking hold of God's covenant. So if we're keeping the commandments of God, including the fourth commandment, we are part of spiritual Israel. We read here in Isaiah, also the sons of the stranger, right? This is not Israel, that join themselves to the Lord, to serve him and to love him in the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it and taketh a hold of my covenant is spiritual Israel. Now we're talking about this idea of this covenant, right? So we find ultimately that there's that the Sabbath is in the Ten Commandments. Now, the Sabbath was created from the beginning of time, right? It was instituted in the week of creation. But we also find the Sabbath again in the Ten Commandments. The reason for this is when God's people were carried away into captivity, ultimately they'd lost their identity. They were no longer apart from the world. They'd forgotten the Sabbath commandment. So when God used Moses to bring them out of the wilderness, he reminded them of essentially the commandments. And so much so, they were so of such importance, we read in Exodus 31:18, that God gave Moses two tablets of testimony, tablets of stone written with the finger of God. So it was literally so important to God that he literally wrote the Ten Commandments with his own finger in stone. Now, we should be able to see that, you know, this is because God does not want us to forget our identity once again. The fourth of those commandments we find in Exodus 20, verse 8 through 11, is remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you are to labor, do all day work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath, the Lord thy God. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth and rested in the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed and the Sabbath and hallowed it. Right? These are powerful words. If we pattern match a little bit the Ten Commandments, we'll find the only commandment where God asks us to remember, right? It's not remember not to kill. It's not remember not to steal. It's the fourth commandment. The fourth commandment is the only commandment to start with the word remember, right? Of the Ten Commandments, we find that it's also the positioning is interesting. So of the Ten Commandments, the first three are how to treat God, the last six are how to treat man, and the fourth is the bridge between God and man. So the Sabbath has an important role in bridging the gap between God and us. We read, the Sabbath is a memorial in the work of creation, a sign in the love of God, and also a pledge given by God to man. So by keeping the Sabbath, we're pledging ourselves to God and accepting his blessings. The Sabbath worship and on the correct day, right, the seventh day, Sabbath, we are essentially instructed is our sign of loyalty. So we are showing God by keeping the seventh day, we are proving who our God is. Deuteronomy 5, verses 12 through 15, we read that a direct and specific command that God's people will observe the Sabbath. Now, this is to me is like, yes, you will eat your dessert, right? Like, keeping the Sabbath is such a blessing. Keeping the Sabbath means that I don't have to worry about client calls. I don't have to worry about servers going down. I don't have to worry about anything because God will create a pause for anyone that keeps the Sabbath. He literally pauses your week. Try it for yourself. Try it for yourself and prove me wrong. I promised you, when I started really keeping the Sabbath is when I realized that everything else just paused. God will work a miracle over Sabbath. Now, there are some people who, you know, have a job on Sabbath, right? I mean, and I've seen in countless instances through our church how people who have said, I can't work on Sabbath, some of them end up having a miracle and their boss just moves their schedule around. Others get fired. But within a period of time, they always come back on top. God will always repay his in typically a double proportion. So again, I liked my tangents. Okay, so here we are. We're reading, the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt and that your Lord God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. Now, this doesn't mean that only people that brought out of Egypt have to observe the Sabbath. Don't be narrow-minded. We see how many verses the Bible says, right, that it's not about just Israel only, right? We also find in Exodus, and this is where God gets even more direct, right? He says that the seventh Sabbath is a day of rest. Whosoever does any work on the Sabbath will be put to death. Now, this is as strong as a deterrent as God can use to illustrate that any separation from God is death. This doesn't mean that because you worship on the Sabbath, which is an arbitrary thing, you should be put to death in that sense. It means that because you have broken a law, a commandment of God, because you have chosen that you don't want to align yourself with God, right? So yes, the wages of sin are death, but more interestingly, not keeping the Sabbath on the day that God commanded us, yes, is a sin, but it's us saying that it's a choice. So it's not, we shouldn't look at it so it's not legalistic. It's just simply binary, right? So yes, this is incredibly serious. Sabbath worship, unlike any other commandment, is a demonstration of free will, right? It's a choice on who we serve. We could actually go through, I have a course on the law of God. Highly recommend you look at that course. Ultimately, what you find out is, so I'm all about building like communes. That's kind of like what I'm trying to do right now. I want to build a commune. You know, I want to build a series of communal living for people to get away from the world and experience nature. And as I'm going through and creating ultimately, what are the rules? Because you have to have rules in a society. Every society needs some rules. So what are the basic, like, how do we have like really high level rules that are just like don't impose your free will on other people, right? That's literally my rule, right? Just don't impose your free will. And as we go through, the Ten Commandments are, it's just basic decency. Don't kill people. Don't steal things. Don't steal somebody's, you know, life, their wife, their possessions, you know, their reputation. Like it's the Ten Commandments are actually just a basic moral code. But the Sabbath is, and so the point of that is that you could keep the Ten Commandments with the exception of the Sabbath and say, well, you know, I'm doing this just because this is the right thing to do. It's the right thing to do not to kill people. That's why the Sabbath is there, is that bridge. The Sabbath there is ultimately a mechanism. Do we trust God or do we distrust God? Do we choose God, or do we choose self or others? Now, this Sabbath is an interesting mechanism that we have that's kind of similar, actually, to what Adam and Eve had in the Garden of Eden, right? Adam and Eve had a mechanism in the Garden of Eden, and theirs was a tree, right? This tree allowed them to demonstrate their free will if they chose to do so, which they ended up doing. God warns us, warns Adam, that the test of their loyalty was in eating of a single tree. Now, what gets me is this is not a tough request, right? They had access to probably, like, I don't know, hundreds of trees. They weren't hungry. They didn't, you know, like, it was not like they, you know, were on a desert island and they only had one tree and God said, don't eat from this, right? And but they're like, but we're hungry. No, they had tons of trees. They were not hungry, right? It was just one tree, say, symbolically, don't eat from this tree. Now, it was a mechanism, right? They were given a simple request, kind of like we're given, right? They were told, you know, well, since we're told, don't work one day of the week, right? They were told, don't eat from one tree in the garden. And it comes down to ultimately, do we trust God and eat from the tree of life? Or do we trust in human reasoning and eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? We have to make this choice, right? Do we choose God's ways and get the seal of God? Or do we choose our own pathway and be left to the destroyer? Right? Do we take the blue pill and trust God by fully rejecting this world? Or do we take the red pill and try and save ourselves? Okay, silly analogy, but yeah, if you get it, you get it. The point is this. You are servants to whom you obey, whether of sin and of death or obedience unto righteousness. So we demonstrate whose we are by our actions. Now, God has now said that he wants to put our laws into our hearts, okay? And so, again, this is this concept that this is not a legalistic thing of do this because you have to do it, it's a drudge. No, this is just a way of saying, I'm going to choose, Lord, to trust you, and I'll gladly accept one day off a week because it's crazy out there, right? And especially if it's this specific time period that you've given me that you promise that you will pause time for me. So some say, though, okay, I get the, I want to keep the Sabbath, but I'm going to use a day that works for me. Like, really, like the Sabbath, you know, Friday night to Saturday night doesn't work for me. I'm going to do it on Sunday. I'm going to do it on Wednesday, right? And if you're thinking that you can just kind of choose how to worship God, go back in the Bible and remember the story of Genesis 4 to 5, how God instructed man how to worship him in a very specific way. Okay, Abel did as God instructed, and God honored him. Cain did not do as God instructed. This ultimately led to the first murder. So the lesson we have is God has given us instructions that we must follow, right? Do we ultimately worship on the seventh day, right? Do we worship like Abel did? Or do we bring something that God has not asked us and worship on the first day? Be clear, there is a specific day that we are told essentially to worship, right? There's a very specific tree we're told not to eat from. So which day is the Sabbath? Now, the Bible's really clear. It's the seventh day of the week, Sabbath. And you say, well, how do we know which day is the seventh day, right? Well, these names have been paganized. So we call this day now Saturday. And now Saturday comes from ultimately Saturn, right? Which is, it's kind of disgusting how this works, but every day of the week is ultimately honoring a day of pagan gods. So the first day of the week, Sunday, worships the sun god, right? So what's interesting, though, is even though we have these names of the weeks for, you know, kind of Western-type countries, when we go through into more than 100 ancient and modern even languages, the seventh day of the week is still named Sabbath or something equivalent to that, right? Sabbat, Saboto, I get Shabbat, right? That's an easy, obvious one. Sambata, all of these are very close and very clearly pointing to Sabbath. And all these refer to the seventh day of the week. Now, again, there's a whole list of these names, and you can go through in every one of them. They're all very easily recognizable and where they came from. But the point is this. The day of the week has never changed. Now we can go into history. So now this is, the great historian Sozomen, right, said that in his time, the whole world knew, with exception, of Roman Alexandria here, said that the whole known world, right, observed the seventh day of the week as Sabbath. Now we know that because they also mentioned that they're worshiping on the first day. So clearly the first day is not the Sabbath, right, as well as the first. So the people of Constantinople assembled together on the Sabbath as well as others on the first day of the week. So we see how clearly the first day of the week is not Sabbath. Also, we see how during this time period, how pagan Sunday worship started creeping up. Okay, but let's go back. Here's two letters from both the U.S. Naval Observatory as well as the Royal Naval Observatory. When questioned, these are the responses. So the question was, is there any doubt of the continuity of the week? Both confirmed, both of these, the U.S. as well as England, that the weekly cycle dates back to known time and there's not been any change or in our calendar in past centuries that have affected the week in any way. Now, if you're a study of history, you'll know that there were a lot of experiments through time using more or less different variations, right? Egypt starting using 10 days, but it didn't catch on. They fell, right? Rome started using 8 days. They fell. The French Republic started using 10 days, reverted back, right? The Soviets, started using 5 days and then they fell. So it's kind of interesting how even though these localized communities were utilizing a different weekly cycle, the rest of civilization continued to use a 7 day one. Now you may say, okay, well, what about the implementation of the Gregorian calendar? So in September 1752, there was a number of days that were kind of removed in order to shorten up the year. Okay, so the interesting thing though is if you look at the calendar for that, the weekly cycle was unchanged. It went from Wednesday the 2nd to Thursday the 14th. So it'd be like today is actually today is Wednesday, I think. No, maybe today's Thursday. I don't know. Anyways, the point is, it would be like if today was Wednesday in September 1752, and then tomorrow would be the 14th. So today would be the 2nd, tomorrow would be the 14th. It still went from Wednesday to Thursday. The cycle has never changed. God has protected the weekly cycle throughout time. So when exactly does the Sabbath start? It's pretty clear based on understanding of creation. We see that the days begin and end at sundown. So the seventh day Sabbath begins on the sixth day at sundown and then closes on the sundown of the seventh day. So it goes from evening to evening. It goes from sundown till sundown, right? And we see this all throughout the Bible. It's backed up in scriptures where we're told explicitly that we are worship on Sabbath from sundown to sundown. Deuteronomy, at the going down of the sun, right? Second Chronicles, even until about the time of the sun going down. Joshua and the sun, as soon as the sun went down. We find here in Leviticus, it shall be as you a Sabbath, a day of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the ninth month, and even from even until evening, so evening until evening, shall you celebrate your Sabbath, right? Nehemiah had to actually re-educate them on how to keep the Sabbath, and even commanded that the gates be shut down to prevent commerce on Friday afternoon. So again, here we hear how, began to get dark before the Sabbath. Again, all very, very clear when this starts. God demonstrated with even the gift of manna, right, of when the Sabbath was. And so we could go into this. We could see on 6 days they gathered twice as much manna. Now, this is the story of when the Israelites had left Egypt. God gave them bread to eat. The bread is manna. And they were told to collect the manna 6 days, and there was no manna on the seventh day. But on the seventh day, the manna didn't spoil. So it was God showing, right? In fact, that God had blessed and frozen time on the Sabbath day, and God's sign of protection was this manna. Moses was instructed to tell Aaron to take a pot of this manna and put it next to the Ten Commandments to show how important this was. Okay, so at this point, I've laid out my case, right? Now there's more, but the response is usually, I'm getting interrupted normally, right? You know, way before this time, actually, I usually get, what does it matter? Is it valid? There's a lot of responses. And I feel like we've been pre-programmed to give one of these responses because they're always the same responses. I don't get something unique. It's the same thing. It's not that important. It was only for the Israelites. The law is no longer valid, right? Well, we worship on the day that Jesus rose, right? Or Paul kept the first day of the week, or every day should be Sabbath, or God doesn't actually care what's in our hearts, right? And it just goes into this degradation into away from what the Bible has to say and ultimately into our own opinion. So I recommend and I ask, I plead that, and I challenge us to put away our preconceived ideas of what the Sabbath is and to just let us study this logically. Dear Heavenly Father, I ask that you guide us in this. I ask that you send your Holy Spirit to impress upon our minds your will for this and help us to understand your words clearly, because this, from your words, it appears that this is a major issue. And so I ask, Lord, that you impress upon our heart the weight of this issue. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So again, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show ourselves approved, rightly dividing, unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The Bible says we're to think and study for ourselves. So don't take my word for this. I just want you to use these Bible verses and go and come up to your own conclusions based on what the Bible has to say, based on the leading of the Holy Spirit, right? But remembering that you can't take the word of your pastor or the word of your church, because ultimately we are going to be judged individually. So whatever we decide, however we act, that will be on us. And if we don't study this for ourselves, that's still on us. We have the ability to. So we can take this first one. Some people say that, that Sabbath is not very important, but God kept the Sabbath. Right? We've already talked about how God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, right? In it, he had rested from all his work. And he had made this wonderful day to be remembered, right? And Psalms tells us, reminds us that the Sabbath is to be remembered, right? Here it is again, Exodus 28 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day. The Lord rested and blessed the Sabbath day, right? In Romans, we read the invisible things of him. So the things that are invisible that God has given us from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. So they are without excuse. So we are without excuse. It says we are to understand the invisible creation of God, the law, which contains the Sabbath. And this is to be understood, even the invisible things that are not seen. To understand what's not seen, we must look to God for guidance, not the tradition of man, right? But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. We have to be praying for the Holy Spirit to lead us and understand what his message truly is. So God blessed the seventh day Sabbath and gave it to Adam as a sign of rest, right? It was a day of rest. It was a memorial sign of God's power and love. So the Sabbath is important to God, right? And then people say, well, the Sabbath is only for the Israelites though, right? And again, we can go through this. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath and observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual covenant forever, right? So who are the children of Israel? And we find that Paul, who is interesting, present at the stoning of Stephen, which is when in AD 34, when the Jews were cut off, when the close of probation for the Jewish nation as a whole, not individually, but as a nation as a whole, was cut off. So he's using this analogy that a tree has branches, right, referring to Israel. And this is now broken off. Israel is now broken off from the branch. And that the wild tree, referring to non-Israels or Gentiles, are now grafted in. So if you continue in this goodness, otherwise thou shalt be cut off. And they also abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in. So what we find is that they are not of spiritual, they are not all of Israel, which are Israel. Right? Spiritual Israel ultimately is the children of the promise are counted for the seed. So a Jew is not one who is inwardly, right? But is one of inwardly, not outwardly. right? A Jew is not one because of circumcision. A Jew is someone who decides, no, I want to keep the commandments of God. You know, the Israels are whom are pertained to adoption. So in Romans 4, 9-4, we're told that spiritual Israel, through the promise of Jesus, has become Israelites. We are spiritual Israelites. Ephesians, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the household of God. Galatians, therefore they which are of faith are the same as the children of Abraham. If ye be of Christ, ye are heirs according to his promise. This is just super, super straightforward, that we don't have to be a literal Jew in order to be an Israelite. We are spiritual Israel. And so spiritual Israel, we need to be keeping the commandments of God, which includes the Sabbath, which is a perpetual covenant. And we even find out in Isaiah, it's clear that even after this earth, right, in the new earth that is to come, from one Sabbath to the next, we will come and worship the Lord. So in heaven, we will be keeping the Sabbath. Not just the Jews. Everyone that goes to heaven will keep the Sabbath. And to go to heaven, you're going to need to keep all the Ten Commandments. And more than that, more importantly, even accepting the gift that Christ has given us. Well, they're equally important. So that's a whole nother conversation. Okay. So then some will say to me, okay, yeah, but the law is no longer valid. Jesus came, right? And it says that, Jesus nailed it to the cross, right? So they usually only quote verse 14, but you got to look at the entire thing. People that quote one verse, right, oftentimes are misquoting things. So you kind of got to see things in context. So when we read this, we're not extracting just this one little piece. We want to read the entire verse and the verses around it. So the entire verse says, blotting out the ordinances, okay, ordinances, right, nailing those to the cross, okay, and a show openly trembling over them, let no man then judge you and eat or meat or inspect of Sabbath, of the Sabbath days, okay. So then people right there say, well, don't let anyone judge you about, you know, keeping the Sabbath. Well, first off, read the next line, which are a shadow of things to come. So we're not talking about the Sabbath, we're talking about Sabbath days. We're talking about the ceremonial law. There was a number of different Sabbath days, holy days, which were a shadow of things to come. They're all pointing forward to Christ returning, right? So ultimately what we're saying here is that when Christ, when Christ died on the cross, we find that the sanctuary, the veil dividing the holy and the most holy place in the sanctuary, was torn in two from top to bottom. So not without man's hands. It was like 4 inches thick or something. Torn from the top to the bottom. So God tore it open, it ultimately showing the emptiness, that God was no longer in the most holy place. And this showed that all these ceremonial offerings, all the stuff that, if you got to take my course on Plan of Redemption, you'll see how the sanctuary system was pointing forward to Christ, the Lamb of God that comes to take away the sins of the world. There was no longer needed a ceremonial Lamb of God because we had the actual Lamb of God, right? So you can't say that, you can say that the ceremonial law was done away with, but not the moral law, right? Because if the moral law was done away with, then it's okay to steal and kill, right? But we have to understand that God is constant. God's law, his moral law, is fixed, right? Psalms 119, 89. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in the heavens. Your way is fixed. These tablets of stone were written with the finger of God. This is personal, right? There's only a few times where God has done something that personal. One, with the creation of man, by forming man out of clay with his own hands. Everything else he just spoke, if you notice that, right? He just spoke and there became galaxies, and he just spoke and there became countless species. But God used his hands to form man, and he used his hands to show us his law. Now you'll say, okay, well, we actually worship on the day that Christ rose, okay? And so that argument makes no sense, because Jesus was sacrificed on Friday. He rose on Sunday, but he rested on Sabbath. So even in Jesus' death, he showed us that he rested on the Sabbath day, right? Also, show me one verse in the Bible that says that you know, we're to worship on the first day of the week. Now, there isn't one, to be clear. There are countless verses that tell us that we're to be worshiping on the Sabbath day, right? In fact, all throughout, we find that Jesus, here we read how, you know, in addition to Jesus being resting in the grave, his followers all rested, on the Sabbath. But after that, right, we throughout Jesus' life, by the way, Jesus, as his custom was, went in the synagogue on the Sabbath, right? Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. And maybe most importantly, Jesus says, think that I am not come to destroy the law, I'm come to fulfill, right? So the Sabbath is something that Jesus values. He's not coming to destroy the Sabbath or the moral law, right? And we'll talk about his disciples in a second. But some people say, well, what about how we shouldn't be in bondage and observing specific days or laboring in vain, right? And this has nothing to do with something as important as a day, which God clearly identified as an activity God did himself, right? As something that God placed as permanently as fixed in the Ten Commandments, in the moral law, and something that Jesus did on earth. And we'll get to a second here, how his disciples did after he left. So this is this idea of... ultimately, we read how in order to sustain erroneous doctrines on unchristian practices, so in order for people to say that the Sabbath is not Sabbath, right, it's not the seventh day of the week, people are seizing upon passages of Scripture, separating them from the context, and quoting half or a single verse to try and prove their point, when the remaining portion would show exactly the opposite. And we've already demonstrated this earlier, right? So, ultimately, you could say, okay, let no man judge you in respect to the Sabbath day, but it doesn't say that. It says the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of the things to come. So again, this is pointing to the ceremonial law, right? It's pointing towards Jesus now ministering for us as his high priest, as our high priest. So Jesus, the true sacrifice, had done away with the need for temple ceremonial system, right? While Jesus worshiped in the temple continued, the participation was now redundant. And so while people were like so used to going to the temple and things like this, in the sense of, and wanting to bring offerings and this, that was had to understand that it was now redundant. They needed to be pointing towards the work, the high priest in heaven. Now, some people say, okay, well, Paul kept the first day of the week. Look in Acts 2, 20, verse 7, right? But again, let's read this in context. Upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came to break bread together, okay, Paul preached to them, ready to depart tomorrow, and continued his speech until midnight. Now, this is not talking about Sunday, because when does Sabbath end? When does the first day of the week begin? At sundown on Sabbath. So they're now talking about, ultimately, they had dinner after Sabbath, and then Paul preached till midnight, which is the first day of the week. Right. Again, putting things in context, 1 Corinthians 16:2, people say, well, on the first day of the week, give your tithe. But no, Paul clearly said, before I come, collect all the offerings during the week so that when I get there, you won't collect them on Sabbath. Right. It's this idea of like people will use this one verse in Acts 27, what they misunderstood because they're not looking at understanding that when the Sabbath starts and ends, and they completely disregard, conveniently, the first two verses of the Bible, of Acts. Paul, as his manner was, went in on the Sabbath days. It was Paul's custom to keep the Sabbath. He didn't keep the first day of the week, right? Paul reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath. There's the next verse, the next chapter, right? So again, all throughout Acts, we find that Paul is going into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, that the voices of the prophets were reading on the Sabbath day, right? And this is 30 years after Christ's resurrection, right? This is around 45 AD that Paul wrote this, okay? So the Sabbath day is here's another example, that amongst the whole city came to hear the word of God on the Sabbath day, okay? So this was clearly a continuation of the Sabbath day. For those, now, it can't make it any clearer than this. If we go into Hebrews 4, for those which we have believed to enter into rest, the Sabbath rest, Okay, as he said, I have sworn in my wrath and entered in my rest, and the works are finished from the foundation of the world, right? So talking about the rest of the foundation of the world, this is the creation, Sabbath, right? He spake in a certain place on the seventh day on this wise. And God rested on the seventh day. So we're talking about the Sabbath, right? And then he says, today, if you hear his voice, and this is a lesson, a message for us. If you hear God's voice speaking and clearly laying out what the Sabbath is, don't harden your hearts. And then we have the most logical statement here. For if Jesus had given them a different day to rest on, if Jesus had said, hey, we have a new Sabbath, then wouldn't he have spoken about it? There's not one word of Jesus saying, hey, we have a new Sabbath. And yet there's so many verses about the Sabbath being the seventh day. Again, it's clear in the future, one Sabbath to another, right? After the new heavens, after the new, in the new earth, we'll still keep the Sabbath. And then people say, well, fine, but every day should be the Sabbath. And this is typically where the conversation starts to digress, right? And it's like, okay, but the response is simply Isaiah 8:20. To the law, the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. Right? If you're contradicting God's law, then there's no spiritual light in you. We're warned in 1 Timothy 4, verse 1, that some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. So if someone says, oh, God only cares about what's in our heart, they don't care about the day we worship, this is the work of the deceiver. And God tells us, blessed is the man that doeth this, that keeps the Sabbath day, right? That keeps the law of God and does not pollute it. Everyone that keeps the Sabbath, I will bring into my holy mountain. So do you want to join God in his holy mountain? Then doesn't it make sense that we listen and keep his Sabbath? So then you may be saying, okay, well, like, what happened? Who changed the Sabbath then? Like where did this come from? Right? And again, in Acts, we find that we were warned that after his departing, there would be perverse things. Grievous wolves would come among you, sparing the flock, not sparing the flock. And of your men will arrive, speaking perverse things, drawing away the disciples after them. Therefore, watch and what? Remember. Remember the seventh day, that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. So we are to watch and remember that there will be some departing, right? We read in 1 Timothy again, in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to doctrines of devils. So the fourth commandment, the one that starts with remember, right, is incredibly important. So who changed it? Why is there now we worship on the first day of the week? Right? And the seventh day Sabbath has actually, you know, again, been around since the beginning of time. It only changed, right, in 4th century AD. So the question is, we ask ourselves, and I'll get into how it was changed, but let's ask ourselves this question first, right? We need to really think, who are we worshiping? Are we worshiping God's law, or are we worshiping man's tradition? Right? Ultimately, this is more than just a day, right? Are we worshiping the Son of God, or are we worshiping the Sun God? Ultimately, again, we have to understand that the Sun God is pagan worship. If you worship Christ on the day of the sun, are you actually worshiping Christ? Let's get into who changed the day. Now, I cover this deep in my course on theism, but let's just go back in history and let's think about, you know, we're right here about 300 years after Jesus' ministry started, Nazarene movement, you know, or the apostolic church, right? The early Christian church had extended to the most of the known world. We're told this in the Bible, right? And Constantine, who came into power, needed to rule an empire. And it was hard because of the Christians and the pagans. He needed to rule easier through one religion. Now, the way he achieved this full dominion was very crafty. And Constantine decided to unite the empire under one religion. We read that Constantine served on the Roman Empire Diocletian and Galerius, and this was understood that the persecuting didn't work, by the way. Right? The more they persecuted Christians, the more they sprung up. So in 306, when he became emperor, right, and full emperor by 324, he had already crafted his plan. There's a book, Lectures on the History of the Eastern Church, that says that Constantine's coins bore on one side the name of the letters of Christ, and on the other side, the figures of the sun god. And so he literally could not take himself from removing himself from paganism, because that's what he was rooted in. The retention of the old pagan name, Solus Dies, or Sunday, for the weekly, is great measure owing to the union of pagan and Christian sentiment, which, with the first day of the week, was recommended by Constantine to his subjects, pagan and Christian alike, as the venerable day of the sun. Now, this was ultimately this idea that instead of persecuting Christians, he simply adopted Christianity and merged it in with paganism. And this is what formed Catholicism. So the Edict of Milan in 313 was an agreement to stop killing Christians if they worship on Sabbath, and instead try to bring them into one standard religion. Constantine allayed the fears of his subjects by publishing the same year two edicts. The first enjoined the solemn observance of Sunday, and the second directed the regular consultation of ultimately pagan practices. Okay, so that's this idea of he created two laws, the first to observe Sunday instead of Sabbath, and the second to regularly visit with fortune tellers. Constantine labored at this time untiringly to unite the worshipers of the old and new religion into one. So all of his blending and melting together Christianity into heathenism, right? Ultimately was this, we could see through it, right? Was him making his Sunday law. So Christians shall not Judaize or be idle on the Sabbath. Now this was a message from high-ranking Catholic leader during Constantine's time, Eusebius of Caesarea. And he was quoted that, again, that they should on the Lord's Day. Now they've taken Sunday, the day Sunday, the for sun worship, and just rebranded as the Lord's Day. And so they still acknowledge that the Sabbath is the seventh day, but that we have this new day, right? This new day of the Lord. And as Christians, they should not do any work on this, this new day of the Lord. But they should work on Sabbath. Constantine clearly remained loyal to paganism, and chose Christianity as a way to conduct his political propaganda. Now, we know this because in his decree based on March 7, 321 AD, he writes, "On the venerable day of the sun, let the magistrate and the people residing in the cities rest, and let all the workshops be closed." Ultimately, they created a Sunday law, which we will find, if you look in my course Final Warning, is coming back around again. So Sol Invictus was the official sun god of the Roman Empire, which dated back to Nimrod, and despite a concerted effort to revise history, right, this merge with paganism was incredibly clear. And we can even trace the date to December 25th, which is the first day that was declared the day of the sun god, and then also later associated with the birth of Jesus. And that's how we have Christmas being on this December 25th, which is actually the date of the first day of sun god, but it's related to the solstice. Okay, let's move on. The point is this: a date which is clearly not Jesus' actual day of birth. Why? We can get into that in another course. So this is important to understand that we read here, and this is the Catholic University of America, okay, in a bibliological reference, right, says, "Constantine's decree marked the beginning of a long, though intermittent series of empirical decrees in support of Sunday rest." Okay, we can read from the Vatican's website in Laodicea that Sunday, like the Jewish Sabbath, right, so they acknowledge the Sabbath is on the seventh day, is meant to be a day which heals our relationship with God, and Sunday is the day of our resurrection. Okay, but we can see this organization is leveraging we're going to find that they're leveraging a climate change agenda to push this national day of rest on Sunday. Now, we'll get into this later. You'll see this. But the point is simply this, is the papacy is not shy, right? The catechism itself clearly acknowledges that they were the ones to change the day of worship from the seventh day to the first. right? And these are narratives which try and say that Jesus was, you know, the early adopters changed this. It's not biblical, right? Find one verse that supports this and then reconcile why the Catholic Church admits to making the change directly. The Sabbath has been replaced by Sunday. Christians should seek recognition of Sunday. Sunday, which is rightly called the Lord's Day. Here's a high-ranking Catholic, again, says, you know, Bishop Eusebius says, we have transferred them, right, to the Lord's Day. So the Sabbath has been transferred, and it's more honorable than the Israeli Sabbath. Well, who gave them this ability to transfer? The Church, after changing the day of rest from the Jewish Sabbath, or seventh day of the week, to the first, made the third commandment refer to Sunday as the day they kept as holy, the Lord's Day. So now we're finding out that they're literally changing the Ten Commandments. The Catholic Church, for over 1,000 years before the existence of Protestant, by virtue of her divine mission, changed the day from Saturday to Sunday. Here it is, black and white, Catholic Mirror. Look it up, September 23rd, 1894. Clearly states, Converts Catechism for Doctrine by Reverend Peter Gurman. Question, which is the seventh day? Right? Answer, Saturday is the seventh day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church in the Council of Laodicea transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Question, have you any other way of proving that the Church has power to institute festivals of precept? Answer, ultimately, she had not such power. If she had not such power, she could not have done it, what she did. A change that there's no scriptural authority. So, by changing the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday, the Catholic Church has demonstrated her ecclesiastical power. We read here that it rests upon the authority of the Catholic Church and not upon an explicit text from the Bible. So if you've been making the argument that, oh, well, you know, there's the Bible. No, the Catholic Church clearly says that it has nothing to do with the Bible. It's tradition. Tradition. All right. The act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. Okay. It is evident that the Catholic Church has the power to change the commandments. If we consulted the Bible only, we would still have to keep the seventh day. That is Saturday, with the Jews instead of Sunday. This is a course in religion in Catholic high schools here. Sunday, Catholic Press, 1900. Sunday is a Catholic institution and can be defended only on Catholic principles. From the beginning to an end of Scripture, there is not a single passage that would warrant the transfer of the week from the last day to the first. Here, Sunday Visitor, 1950. Protestants do not realize that by observing Sunday, they are accepting the authority of the spokesperson of the Church, the Pope. Catholic Record, London. Sunday is our mark of authority. The Church above is above the Bible, and its transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. So, we find out that in Revelation how there will be this little horn speaking blasphemous things. Is blasphemy saying that they're above the Bible, they're above God? The Roman Catholic Church changed the observance of the Sabbath to Sunday by right of divine infallible authority given to her by her founder, Jesus Christ. But was the Catholic Church founded by Jesus? I think it was founded by Constantine. The Protestant claiming the Bible was to be the only guide of faith has no warrant for observing Sunday. In this manner, the Seventh-day Adventists are the only consistent Protestant. So the Catholic Church says that the only consistent Protestant religion are Adventists. That's interesting. What do the other denominations have to say about the Sabbath? Anglican, Philip Carrington. Nowhere in the Bible is laid down that the worship should be done on Sunday. Isaac Williams. Not because the Bible, but because the Church has enjoined it. Baptist, Hiscox. The Sabbath day was not Sunday. Baptist Manual. Again, Baptist Manual. What a pity it comes, branded with the mark of paganism and christened with the name of the Sun God, adopted and sanctioned by the papal apostasy, and bequeathed as a sacred legacy to Protestantism. Talking about the Sunday Sabbath. Baptist again, William Carville. There was never any formal authority to change from the Israeli Seventh-day Sabbath to Christian first-day observance. Taylor, Sabbath, we had a question. The sacred name of the seventh day is Sabbath. The fact is too clear to argument. Baptist Quarterly. The Sabbath was established originally long before Moses, and in no special connection with the Hebrews, but as an institution for all mankind in commemoration of God's rest after 6 days of creation. It was designed for all descendants of Adam. Let's move over to Episcopalian, Bishop Seymour. We have made the change from seventh day to the first day of the week, from Saturday to Sunday, on the authority of the one holy Catholic Apostolic Church of Christ. Lutheran. We have seen how gradually the impression of the Israeli Sabbath faded from the mind of the Christian Church. Like, I can keep going on. My voice is getting tired. Lutheran, error in teaching. The Sunday has taken the place of the Old Testament Sabbath. There is simply no law in the New Testament to that effect. Like, these are the founders of other, you know, Protestant religions that have just not fully separated themselves from the papacy. The observance of the Lord's Day, which they call Sunday, is founded not on any commandment of God, but on the authority of the Catholic Church. Let's move to Methodist. The moral authority contained in the Ten Commandments, right? Every part of this law must remain in force, including the Sabbath. The moral law contained in the Ten Commandments, Christ did not take away. Every part of this law must remain in force in all ages. There is no passage telling Christians to keep that day. Harris Rawl, Christian Advocate, Methodist. It must be confessed that there is no law in the New Testament concerning the first day. Charles Buck, Theological Dictionary, Methodist. Let's move to Congregational. Sunday is not in the Scripture. Absolutely without any authority in the New Testament. That's Abbott, Christian Union. Fowler, Mode and Subjects of Baptism. There is no command in the Bible requiring us to observe the first day of the week. Dale, Ten Commandments. There is not a single sentence in the New Testament suggests that we incur a penalty by violating the supposed sanctity of Sunday. Blake, Presbyterian now. The teaching of Christ confirms the perpetuity of the Sabbath. Presbyterian, in the rest of the Sunday, no divine law enters. The Lord, even then, the Christians were bound to strict observance of the Sabbath. How, Moody Institute, how can men claim that this is one commandment that has been done away with when they admit that the other nine are still binding? Good question. Look, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this world, it's because there is no light in them. The Bible is very clear that we are to speak essentially what the Bible has to say. I don't know how it can be any clearer, honestly. Like, you can't restate in the negative. If an organization does not keep God's commandments and says that you need to enter in, they're either liars or they're deceivers, right? They're clearly not following the biblical commands. The Sabbath as a memorial of God's creation and power points to him as the maker of the heavens and the earth. Hence, it is a constant witness to his existence and a reminder of his greatness, his wisdom, and his love. Had the Sabbath always been sacred, observed, there could never have been an atheist or an idolater. So this is the erosion of the Sabbath is the erosion of morality. We are called out. Verily my Sabbath shall be, you shall keep, perpetual covenant, right? We read that the Sabbath is a sign between us. Again, whom ye yield yourselves, right, is who you obey. Be it to religion or death or obedience or life, we are instructed to keep all of God's laws. This will demonstrate our vote, right? Our vote at the end time, we're casting a vote. Who we serve? Are we casting a vote for Sunday and sun worship ourselves? Or are we casting a vote by worshiping on Sabbath? The Sabbath is a public token, but the world may recognize the true and living God and who serves the true and living God. The Sabbath is a sign for God, it's a seal of his law. They who not receive the mark of the beast keep the commandments of God. If you want to understand what Revelation 14, you want to get in and understand Revelation, right? And the mark of the beast and the seal of God, right? It's all about the day of worship. What day do we worship? That's our way of casting our vote. It's not a physical thing, right? The seal of God is ultimately a seal. It's a settling of truth. It's a decision of who we serve. Now, it's interesting that the Sabbath is, and check my other courses on this, how I go through how the Sabbath is the seal. Okay? That God made the world in 6 days, setting it apart from all others and holding himself, you know, and ultimately the man of sin, which we just demonstrated who the man of sin was, that's exalting himself above God, right? Thought to change times and laws, right? Thinking to prove that it was not only equal to God, but above God, and change the rest day, placing the first day of the week where the seventh day should be. It's a sign, folks. And Jesus says that I have other sheep that are not of this fold. This means that there are a lot of people, really good people, in the Catholic Church, in the Protestant churches, and even otherwise known as pagan churches. Okay? God has people in every church. Some of them just haven't heard this message yet. And so when we understand what the three angels' messages are, right? The second message is this. This is literally the second angel's message, is to wake up, come out of Babylon, stop worshiping how other churches tell you to worship. Worship your God how God tells you to worship. If we love God, we will keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. You know, the Sabbath is the easiest commandment to keep. It's literally allowing you to have a vacation every week. And why don't we keep it? Right? Again, while it's the easiest commandment, it's also a sign. And so we have to remember that if anyone who keeps the whole law and yet offend one point is guilty of all. So if we keep all nine of the ten commandments, and don't keep the Sabbath, we're guilty of all the commandments. Now, I highly recommend that you watch my video next on final warning, and this will really break it down and hopefully explain this whole process. But the Sabbath is a time of delight. The Sabbath was made for man. It's not a burden, it's a blessing, right? And if we call the Sabbath a delight and not looking at our own pleasure, God will reward us, right? God will honor them that honor him. Every man that keep the Sabbath from polluting it and not take a hold of, and take the hold of God's covenant, God will bring into his holy mountain and make them joyful in the house of prayer. Don't you want to be joyful? Don't you want to come home to God? We are not merely to observe the Sabbath as a legal matter. We are to understand the spiritual bearing on all the transaction of life. All who regard the Sabbath as a sign between them and God, showing that he is God who sanctifies them, will represent the principles of his government. They will bring into the daily practice the laws of the kingdom. Daily it will be their prayer that the sanctification of the Sabbath rest may be upon them. Every day they will have the companionship of Christ and exemplify the perfection of his character. Every day their light shine forth into every good works, but one day is special. The Sabbath calls our thoughts to nature and brings us into communion with the Creator. The Sabbath is ultimately, it's a time that we should be out in nature. We should be doing good deeds. We should be connecting with God. We should be just taking a break. We need to be digitally detoxing for sure, right? The Sabbath is a time of healing. We read, lift up your eyes on high and behold who hath created these things, that bringeth out their host by number. He hath called them by names in the greatness of his might, that he is strong in power, not one faileth. Look to me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. God is telling us we are to look to him and get healing, get strength. God will strengthen us. He will hold us with the right hand of his righteousness. These are promises. The Sabbath is not only a day of rest, it's also a time to minister to others. This is not about legalism. It's about thinking about others, right? We have this ability to think about being in the service of God first and of all. And think about, you know, who can we bless on the Sabbath day? We are to visit the fatherless, the widows in affliction, right? This is how we should be spending this special time. And ultimately, I can just tell you that for those that are tired, for those that are weary, those that are worn out, those that say it's just too much for me, then try. Try God's way. I challenge you this Friday night, before sundown, clear everything away. Close your phone down. Do everything you need to do. Make a little extra food in the refrigerator. And maybe pack a picnic lunch. And when Sabbath comes, just power down. Don't think about clients. Don't think about the world. Don't be browsing social media. Don't be distracted by the world. And just take time to be in nature. Take time to think about God. Take time to allow God to impress you of who you should be reaching out to and who you can heal, who God can heal through you. And so with this, I just pray, dear God, please impart upon us the blessing that is your Sabbath day. Help us to understand your desire to connect with us, your desire for us to step aside from our daily toils and to hear your voice. Lord, I ask that you this Sabbath open up an opportunity for us to be in nature, open up an opportunity for us to take a rest from the chaos of this world and remember that you're coming soon and you're going to heal us from everything that's here. And so, Lord, we just put our faith in you. I ask, Lord, that you send your Holy Spirit to really, truly impress upon our minds your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.